It is October, and we have candy corn. Good morning, Multiverse.
Delivering the multiverse since 2009. Live from our studios in Kansas City, this is SciFiForMe.tv.
If that's what they're calling it, that's what they're calling it. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this edition, this hour. We've got the latest headlines across science fiction, fantasy, and horror genres, all for you in one place. And we are brought to you in part by superherostuff.com, where you can get a 10% discount when you use the promo code SciFiForMe10 when you check out. And that can be used in combination with other offers and sales at times, not every single one, but we do like to save you a little bit of money. Tell them Sci-Fi for Me sent you. All right, so we do have quite a bit of news to get to this morning, and of course we start as we usually do with events, because there are a number of them, even though our schedule keeps changing. And we do make adjustments here as we're able. And Mrs. Boss, Mindy, is here this morning with some updates. Good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, we did add some events to our list this week. And it's nice that I've noticed when you get to the lists of the events that have been affected by everything right now, that seems to be slowing down. But I don't think it's so much that it's slowing down due to what's going on in the world. It's more that everybody had already decided to go ahead and either cancel or go virtual. And, you know, it's just kind of like, I don't know how to look at it. But, you know, a lot of events are getting scheduled for next year, which is really cool. And they are also promoting some of their, you know, sister events or baby events that they're trying to get out there and push so that people can still go, but you're not going to come into these crowds of 20, 30,000 people. You may only have 100 or two. And they're doing everything they can to keep it safe so that they can continue to have these, I guess you can call them baby cons at this point. So, you know, what do you get when you have a big con? They get a little baby con. But anyway, so this week, our new cons are Comicon Prague in Prague, Czechia. We got SoulCon in Columbus, Ohio. Canadian Toy Con in Burlington, Ontario, Canada. Burlington Comic Book Show in Burlington, Ontario, Canada. Corpus Christi Comic and Toy Show, Corpus Christi, Texas. Mountaineer Comic Con in Morgantown, West Virginia. PokeCon LA in West Monroe, Louisiana, and finally Tacticon in Denver, Colorado. So that brings our list up to 2,134 events. So like I said, a lot of these bigger cons are starting to put on baby cons to try to get, you know, people to be able to enjoy the convention scene again. And we look for these announcements on all social media. And if you know of one, let us know. You know, send us a note somewhere on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter and say, hey, this is going on, and we want to make sure that it's on the list so anybody else can go see this. And not only are, you know, we have one of the biggest and best lists online, I think, but with these little events that are happening, we are continuing to give the weather so that you know what to expect if you do go to them. And so here are the weather for the events that are happening next week. Thank you.
And continuing our events coverage, we do have a few that have changed, that have gone virtual, and we do have a few of those. Some going virtual this weekend. Let's start there. Eurocon in Rijeka. Oh, where was this one? HRV is... Eurocon, Rijeka. I didn't have that written down. MagWest in San Jose, California, going Twitch and Discord, October 2nd through the 4th. NukeCon in Omaha, Nebraska, virtual on Discord now through the 4th. Shake, Battle, and Roll in Southampton, UK, on Discord, October 2nd through 4th. BrickCon in Seattle, now today and tomorrow. SuperCon in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, today and tomorrow as well. WasabiCon in Jacksonville, Florida, on Twitch, October 3rd and 4th. HeroFest in Bern, Switzerland, on Twitch, October 3rd through the 11th.
Croatia.
Okay. Eurocon in Rijeka, Croatia, because, of course, HRV means Croatia. Some of these postal codes are derived from other versions of the name, so sometimes it throws me. I apologize. The Global Gaming Expo, G2E, in Las Vegas, Nevada, going virtual starting on Monday and going through the 8th. And we wanted to make a note of that here. Any of these where there is not a mention of a channel, whether it's YouTube or Twitch or Discord, you can find the links into their virtual site on their website. And we do have those links available over at scififorme.com in the virtual con report that Mindy puts out, so you can find those fairly easily. And of course, after the show is done, we will put those links in the show description below the video as well. And we do have some reschedules, some different dates going virtual and changing. Big Ben Comic-Con in Alpine, Texas, going virtual November 14th. Aresia in Boston, Massachusetts, virtual January 15th through the 18th of 2021. The Anthro New England event in Boston, Massachusetts, going virtual February 25th weekend. And the Argentina Game Show in Buenos Aires has new dates. They are scheduled now for November 6th through the 8th. And we have just a handful of canceled events. And this is probably the shortest one of these that we've had in quite a while, because they have just been piling up every weekend. But now we've just got this short one. Frankfurt Comic Con in Kentucky. The Wild Wild West Steampunk Convention in Tucson, Arizona. Paisley Comic Con in the UK. Cardiff Comics Carnival, also in the UK. Scarefest in Lexington, Kentucky. Frightmare of on the Falls in Niagara Falls, Ontario, Canada. Viking Con in Copenhagen, Denmark. Mind Fair in Indianapolis. And the Otherworld Theater Virtual Gala in Chicago. And thereby hangs a tale, because originally we had the Otherworlds virtual event on our list of things happening this weekend. Turns out that is not the case. The Otherworld Theater's virtual gala has been suspended indefinitely while the company conducts an investigation into allegations against Otherworld and their Moonrise Games live-action role-play program, involving safety concerns, harassment, mismanagement, unprofessional behavior, financial concerns, poor business practices, and so on. Otherworld has posted on their Instagram account that three of their board members have stepped down and out of their leadership roles during the investigation. They are looking for an outside third party to help figure out what exactly has been going on and what needs to change. Meanwhile, all events are on hold while they focus on resolving the matter. So there is that. If you are near Santa Monica, California, you may find this of interest. Disney Plus will be hosting a drive-in festival at the Barker Hangar starting Monday, going through the 12th of this month. It kicks off with a screening of their new series, The Right Stuff, which will air on National Geographic, And it will feature screenings of various Disney, Star Wars, Pixar, National Geographic content throughout the week. It wraps with a premiere of the Disney Plus original film, Clout. Tangled's 10th anniversary will be part of that, the 40th anniversary of Empire Strikes Back. The Sound of Music, they'll have a sing-along. And they are taking reservations because it's a limited capacity event, so registration is open now. And we will provide a link in case you're interested. Those of you in the Alita army, you're going to be happy about this. Regal Cinemas announcing October 30th, it's coming back as a re-release in theaters, Alita Battle Angel. And not to be outdone, but Cinemark also posting a tease, getting in on the act. They don't have anything official past this, but they've also acknowledged the Alita army. And we will keep you posted on that as things develop. The Lord of the Rings has resumed production in New Zealand, and Cowboy Bebop is set to start this past Wednesday is when they were supposed to start. And meanwhile, in British Columbia, Batwoman, Charmed, Riverdale, Big Sky, and Nancy Drew all shut down again. This is according to Variety. Apparently, the processing for the COVID tests is taking too long, and it's caused another delay. In New Zealand, shooting is underway on the Netflix adaptation of the Vertigo comic Sweet Tooth. Stefania, I want to make sure I get this right, Stefania LaVie Owen joining the cast, and this is according to Deadline. She will be a regular as Bear, the leader of the Animal Army. This is a group of teens on a crusade against humans that brought about society's collapse. Now, this is being produced by Team Downey, Robert Downey Jr.'s production outfit. Jim Mickle and Beth Schwartz are writing. They will also be the co-showrunners. Warner Brothers Television is producing. It will be 8 episodes. And this little surprise, the remake of The Witches from Robert Zemeckis dropped a trailer. Anne Hathaway, Octavia Spencer, Stanley Tucci in the cast. And this is a remake of the 1990 film that starred Angelica Houston as the Grand High Witch. It's a new adaptation of Roald Dahl's book, originally scheduled for theaters, but it's going straight to HBO Max in the U.S. starting October 22nd. And it will be in theaters internationally October 28th. And we have word from Collider that the Sandman series at Netflix will begin shooting in about 3 weeks. This is according to a post by Neil Gaiman. Let me find it there. There it is, right there. Posting a tease, little picture of a piece of the script, saying that it's going up in 3 weeks. And also according to Collider, Tom Sturridge is in talks to star as Dream. And they say sources tell them Sturridge read for the role earlier this year, along with Tom York and Colin Morgan. And Tim, I guess the invitation was lost in the mail. You didn't read for that part?
I am not tall enough, thin enough. My hair does not do the crazy Dream thing that I think a lot of fans really want to see. Although I have to say that Tom Sturridge definitely, he visually could work the part. Now, of course, he was in Velvet Buzzsaw and Mary Shelley. He's an accomplished actor. And certainly, he would not be a bad choice for the part. So I personally, at this point, I'm perfectly fine with this casting. We'll have to see how it plays out, of course. It's the idea that we're actually, getting the casting coming together is exciting for fans of the series, certainly.
Well, and 3 weeks out, not having a lead character sometimes is cause for concern, but sometimes it works out. I mean, Michael Biehn was a last-minute replacement on Aliens. So
yeah, but I think that with something like this, I mean, there's going to be so much additional shooting that's not going to involve people. Mm-hmm. Because it's going to be an incredibly effects-laden series. I mean, it's right. Just one of those things. I mean, the Dreamlands are, not something you can just find down at the corner.
but wait, I thought Pinewood Studios had everything.
Well, it's entirely possible. Actually, you know, hey, see if the sets from Legend are still around. You could probably get some really great stuff out of that.
Sure.
Unlikely after all these years, but it's exciting news. The long path of getting Sandman to anything resembling a screen has been a definite example of fans going hearing an announcement and everyone gets excited and then it doesn't happen. Yeah. Or they get hear an announcement and go, this sounds terrible. So the fact that, I mean, obviously Good Omens, the success of Good Omens really was a positive in getting this adapted. And of course the fact that we've gone into this period of prestige television where these effects laden TV shows,
right,
that are, you know, Game of Thrones, however you feel about the show, ending aside, is, you know, open the doors. I mean, it's that kind of budget for an ongoing series really, really made it possible to do things like this. So, it's exciting news.
Right, what other exciting news do you have for us?
Well, we're going to come back to television in a minute because I do want to go ahead and jump into film. M. Night Shyamalan has announced the actual title of his new film, and we got seen a little bit of artwork for it. It is going to be called Old. The artwork shows an hourglass with people tumbling down through instead of sand. Now, this is based supposedly, according to the folks over at Collider, it's inspired by a French graphic novel called Sandcastle, which is about 13 people on a beach who discover a body, and on that beach, time works differently. So everyone starts aging very, very fast. And it sounds like this could be a really disturbing story, shockingly, from M. Night, not known for giving us happy, cheerful movies. But it's a really interesting kind of concept, and we'll have to see how this plays out and how much it changes. But I've looked into the graphic novel a little bit myself, and it seems like they're playing with some pretty big themes there about the human condition. So it could be interesting. And of course, that film is starring Rufus Sewell and Embeth Davids. We have heard, of course, that we are potentially, and it seems increasingly likely, getting the original cast of Hocus Pocus back together for the new film. And if you are a fan of Bette Midler's annual Halloween fundraising gala, she's going to be reuniting with Sarah Jessica Parker and Kathy Najimy for that as well. It's going to take place on Friday, October 30th. There is a link to get tickets. We will drop in here for you guys if you want to attend. And she told ET that I can't wait to fly. Oh yeah, we're just talking logistics. So the question of whether or not they are going to return seems to have been in all likelihood solved. Now, if you are waiting on, of course, the new Saw movie, you're waiting on the new Saw movie because, of course, it is moved to 2021, like so many other pictures. And Spiral is getting a lot of interesting buzz, of course, because of the casting, because returning to the Saw universe after Tobin Bell has left. But the director, Stolberg, says the closer we got to the releasing the original release date, the more he was actually worried about that we were going to open. The worst case scenario is that you open and nobody comes because nobody wants to come out into the movie theater. And he's one of the most favorite films he's worked on. Chris Rock is incredible. And really hoping that it would open in the theater, so he's willing to wait. Now, there was also talk apparently about bringing Donald Glover back. Donald Glover back as Detective Tapp from one of the earlier Saw films. And they played around with it in the idea of having him be related to Chris Rock's character. But ultimately, it did not work out. And people have asked Tobin Bell if he's interested in coming back. And he's like, well, sure, I'd be happy to come back if the script is there. It's all about the writing. The writing is great. John Kramer is a King Lear-sized character, in my view. And there's a huge range to him. So we'll have to see what happens. Of course, coming back after being, you know, pretty definitively dead. It's a horror movie. Not stopped anybody before. Speaking of not stopping anything before, we're getting another remake of Firestarter. Now, of course, Stephen King films have been big in the last few years, and some quality Stephen King adaptations, not always the case. And this is not the first remake of Firestarter we've had. But Zac Efron is taking the lead there. Odds are pretty good. He is playing the father of the main character. And of course, this is a story of two people who meet in college, get involved in a clinical trial, and their child develops pyrotechnic abilities, ties into the larger subplot about a sinister government agency that runs through a lot of Stephen King books. And of course, it is one of the more highly regarded Stephen King film adaptations in the original Drew Barrymore. Zack Snyder's Army of Dead. We've talked a little bit about the fact that it's getting an anime spin-off series. They've added some cast members to that. Christian Slater and, excuse me, Kat, Joe Manganiello are also joining the voice cast for that. Of course, they are not alone. This is actually a pretty sizable cast. Some of it actually coming over from the Army of the Dead feature film, Dave Bautista and Tignataro are also reprising their roles in the anime series. Moving over into DVD and Blu-ray, we're getting a lot of things with a lot of extras popping up. Ronin Flix is releasing a two-disc collector's edition Blu-ray of what Richard Roper of the Chicago Sun-Times called the Grisly Horror Gem. That was actually made by the writers of A Quiet Place and produced by Eli Roth. Haunt, which came out last year, is coming to Blu-ray and DVD. The plot is on Halloween, a group of friends encounter an extremely haunted house that promises to feed on their darkest fears. This, of course, always ends well. And it is going to have the original CD soundtrack, 4 posters, reproduction of the haunt map, 6 enamel pens, magnets, 5 hours of special features, all kinds of cool things there. Now, Unhinged, which of course did open in theaters recently, is coming out on Blu-ray, DVD, and digital on the 17th of November. Not a whole lot of features, special features here, but we have an audio commentary from the director and the cinematographer, costume designer, a featurette. Of course, it was not a good trip for the character Rachel, played by Karen Pistorius. Very, very bad road trip. Full Moon Features has basically going to release a ton of cool things if you happen to be a fan of Puppet Master. Their Blu-ray collection trunk opens again, and with movies and action figures. Each trunk is going to be numbered and signed by Charles Band. Tulum's trunk is the big one. Includes all 12 official Puppet Master films, plus 3 mini action figures, Blade, Jester, and Torch. So if you're a fan of this series, definitely something to pick up. This series has been going on for a very long time. 1989 is when the first of the films came out, and Killer Puppets have got a life, apparently. 500 trunks are going to be available, so get them while you can. Blade, Wesley Snipes' super vampiric superhero, is coming to 4K Ultra HD with Blu-ray and digital on December 1st. Excuse me. Best Buy is going to have an exclusive Steelbook edition. Again, another one that's just packed with extras. Audio commentary by Wesley Snipes, Stephen Dorff, the director David Goyer. On one disc, it's on the Ultra HD disc. The Blu-ray disc is going to have a Designing Blade featurette, Origins of Blade, a look at the comic series, and a whole lot more. So if you're a fan of one of the most successful, long before the Marvel Cinematic Universe blew up the way that it did, one of the most successful superhero adaptation films of its time, definitely something to pick out. Now, this is a mixed, your mileage may vary. If you're not a fan of the I Spit on Your Grave series, this will not appeal to you. But if you are, the I Spit on Your Grave 3-disc collector's edition is coming out, and it's going to have the original I Spit on Your Grave, the I Spit on Your Grave Deja Vu, which brings back the original actress, the original star of the first film to play that character again, going back to a place she should not go back to, and growing up with I Spit on Your Grave as the third disc there. 4K scan from the uncut 35mm original camera negative, deluxe custom slipcase, newly commissioned artwork, all kinds of neat things there if you're a fan of that particular disturbing film. I've seen the original a long, long time ago. Found it quite disturbing. Have not seen any of the sequels, I'm afraid. Can't speak to their quality. Arrow Video is releasing the horror comedy Tremors with Kevin Bacon and Fred Ward on 4K Ultra HD and Blu-ray on December 15th. This is one I am definitely interested in picking up. Newly restored in 4K, 60-page book is coming with it, with new writings by the British critic Kim Newman, who's also a fantastic author, by the way, Jonathan Melville, and archive materials, big poster, double-sided poster, six double-sided lobby card reproductions, all kind of cool things. Yeah. That's actually going to be a lot of fun for the fans of that. And Fade to Black is finally coming to Blu-ray. We don't have a date on when this is actually happening, but Vinegar Syndrome's November collection supposedly is going to include this. Now, this starred Dennis Christopher, an actor who you see on TV all the time. And of course, he was in the original TV version of It. And really sort of iconic horror film, but a young man whose isolation and love of movies leads him into a killing spree dressed like classic movie characters. It's a fascinating film. And Scream Factory is also coming up with an undated release for The Evil Dead, the final film of the Evil Dead trilogy, 4K Ultra release of Army of Darkness. Again, we don't have a date on this, but that is coming up. Over on the TV side of things, Blumhouse Television co-president Marcy Weissman is leaving the company. Apparently, there are family issues that she is dealing with over the last year and decided to take the time off. She joined the company in 2016, oversaw scripted and unscripted for the TV side of Blumhouse, and apparently expanded the company quite a bit. Oversaw over more than 16 projects, forged partnerships with iHeartRadio and NBC News, and is generally apparently highly regarded in the company. So our best wishes to her, since considering there seems to be family issues here involved, and we could all use some support when that is happening. Lock and Key, of course, has resumed production, and we have now got some information about Aaron Ashmore actually becoming an official part of the cast. He always was an official part of the cast, but he's been promoted to series regular. And Halia Jones has as well. Brendan Hines from The Tick is joined the cast. He's playing Josh Bennett, charismatic and mysterious new history teacher at Matheson Academy with a secret agenda. Now, if you're familiar with the Lock and Key series, secret agendas don't bode well for our main characters. Now, of course, we've heard that Ridley Scott is going to get back into the business of making an alien movie. There was an attempt actually earlier to make an alien TV show, and Legion and Fargo creator Noah Hawley pitched it, and he has talked about it. Apparently, this is a thing that he was hoping to actually make, and he basically breaks it down as if you're going to have 10 hours of television, maybe two of those are going to be your action horror sequences. You have to have eight other hours. What stories are you telling? And the idea would that it'd be telling a great human drama, as well as the nightmare fuel of the alien universe. So unfortunately, this did not happen, but maybe someday. Sounds like certainly the talent behind Legion and Fargo could have given us an interesting world, alien world. Shudder's horror film, Shudder's horror anthology series Creepshow has started shooting in Atlanta. Of course, we talked about Ashley Lawrence and Keith David joining that cast. Joe Lynch, the director of Mayhem and Everly, is going to be helming one of the episodes of that. And if you've been hearing all the news about the Walking Dead universe, well, this week we also have the Walking Dead universe preview special. They announced that Tales of the Walking Dead is in fact going to be an anthology show, trying to do something different
with the Walking Dead universe. We'll see how that plays out. And this is exciting news. Of course, last week we heard that Clive Barker was basically going to be returning to the world with all kinds of cool stuff. And his Nightbreed film and Cabal, the original novella that it's based on, is got a TV series on the way. It snagged the director of Trick or Treat, Krampus, and Godzilla, King of the Monsters. Michael Dougherty is actually going to be directing this, and this is fantastic. This is if you're a fan of either the original movie or the novella, this is exciting news. Hopefully it turns out well. Barker's currently working on the show Bible, and he said it's exciting after 30 years to go back into these characters and find out who is still speaking to me. Something to look forward to. Now, if you just need one more streaming service because you don't have enough, Arrow Video is announced they are going to have their own subscription-based Arrow platform. And that pretty much started 2 days ago, October 1st. And this is available. You can find it at the usual places you find streaming services. Go to their website, of course, arrowvideo.com. The deeper you dig, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Crumbs, Hatred, Cold Light of Day, Video Man, Herschel Gordon Lewis Feast is actually going to be, are actually available now. Hellraiser 1 and 2, Elvira, Ringu, and the Gamera series. And of course, the Arrow Video Archives, which is quite sizable. You can find it actually arrow-player.com. And Nickelodeon is going to be doing a lot of stuff for the kid horror fans in your life. Basically starting yesterday, Friday, October 2nd. Hauntingly fun, all new episodes, I quote, including Landhouse, Blue's Clues, You, It's Pony. You can head to Nick Jr. to see the full list. Of course, this is family-friendly horror. Moving over to the gaming side of things, if you are a fan of Animal Crossing, you've got your own little Halloween thing going on over there. Some spooky content. There's a new trailer out. Halloween-themed events are going to be added to the game, or have been added to the game as of September 30th. You can go trick-or-treating. That's something that you can't do in a lot of places in the real world right now. So at least you can do it there. Excuse me. Werewolf the Apocalypse, Heart of the Forest is coming out October 13th. You are playing the role of Maya, a woman who arrives in Poland to trace her family roots. Along the way, she discovers some disturbing things about herself, something involving hair and fangs and, of course, a world of the apocalypse, werewolf, the apocalypse, and all the vampire masquerade books and all this great things. This is not the first time this was attempted. There was an earlier attempt to do Werewolf the Apocalypse. Capcom was doing one, Dreamforge. None of these came to fruition. But this is also going to be the first of at least two. Werewolf the Apocalypse Earthblood is a third-person RPG set to release in 2021 in February. If you're a fan of the Blair Witch, you get a new game to play. Hunt a Killer is going to be a sort of board game, like all Hunt a Killer games. You get 6 boxes of puzzles, paperwork, documents, audio clips, and other things to put together a mystery and solve a puzzle. And it involves hunting for someone who's gone into the woods. This will end well, I am sure. And if you're a fan of Dead by Daylight, there's an expansion for Silent Hill. Got a lot of positive buzz. You can play as Heather Mason and Pyramid Head and the school and all the things appear that are, you know, the visual key marks of Silent Hill. You can also be playing as Sybil Bennett. Or actually, you can be dressed as Sybil Bennett. Apparently, Sybil's not a unique character. You actually are Heather Mason taking the appearance. I'm not sure what this is about, actually. And moving over into comic books, Aftershock has one of their titles heading to the screen, courtesy of Norman Reedus from The Walking Dead. They've closed a deal with his production company, Big Bald Head, to do Undone by Blood and bring that to the series. Norman Reedus is potentially going to be the star of this show, the male lead. The premise is that back in the 1970s, Ethel Grady Lane returns to her hometown of Sweetheart, Arizona, with one thing on her mind, killing the man who murdered her family. Clearly this is not the easiest thing to do. She has to find him, and the town has got secrets of its own. And of course, Chadwick Boseman's death shocked and saddened a lot of people. Todd McFarlane over in the Spawn series, issue 311 is going to feature a tribute on the cover. Of course, while it is easy to be forgotten, it's surprising how many people don't seem to realize this, Spawn himself is an African-American character. And as McFarlane says, given the limited amount of minority characters in the comic industry today that are considered major superheroes, I thought it was appropriate for one of these well-known heroes, Spawn, to pay tribute to a man who made a lasting impact on helping shape such a strong superhero of color. Chadwick Boseman is a person who honed his skills and then made a career using them. Then he fought a fight against his own body that showed the true spirit of this man. And there's more, but certainly the cover art is actually pretty impressive. So I'm looking forward to picking that one up as it happens. And finally, coffee. Coffee is a beautiful thing. And Robert Englund and Dread Sled Coffee have unleashed the Robert Englund's Nightmare Blend. We've talked about this before. October 12th is when the deadline for pre-orders is. You can order, start pre-orders now. Go ahead and pick this up if you want it. It comes with a bundle. So you get a two bags of coffee, a limited edition vintage baseball style raglan shirt, and a limited edition mug exclusive to the bundle, magnets, stickers, and more. Oh, you can't just buy anything on itself anymore. You have to get all the things. This is not a bad thing sometimes, though. One of the bags of coffee is exclusive to the bundle and features England looking out of the window of the iconic Elm Street house. And this is a one-time deal. Once this is gone, all this stuff is gone. There's also a contest going on. 50 random orders will receive a 5x5 hologram You're a Winner sticker. But that's not all. If you get it, you'll also get a sign bag from Robert, and one of those 50 winners will receive a grand prize, which includes authentic nightmare gloves crafted by Anders Ericsson of Nightmare Gloves himself. So that's pretty cool. Again, September 28th, just a few days ago, to October 12th is your pre-order window, and we'll post the link to that in the show notes. And that's what I've got for you today, sir.
All right, thank you very much for that, sir. Now, I was sipping coffee at one point. Did you mention that Stranger Things has begun shooting again for their new season?
I did not. I thought we mentioned that last week, but yes, Stranger
Things. Well, we might have. I have slipped since then. Yeah, that happens. Okay, and of course, coming up next week, Mr. Harvey and Macy and Sean have a new Doctor Who discussion that's going to be Thursday at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, and you're going through the list of companions at this point. We just had the Pawns, so who's next?
The Pawns. Now is coming up is Clara. So that we'll have lots to talk about, because not only is there some, you know, divisiveness on some of the storytelling, we don't get that many companions which cross from one doctor to another. That always makes some interesting storytelling choices and character directions. So we'll have some fun talking about her.
Well, and I imagine the different versions of Clara will feed into that as well, because that gives you,
yes, yes, like, there's fun to be had.
Personally, I like the Victorian Clara better, but
I think there's a lot of people who really, really love that version of the character.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, sir.
My pleasure.
All right. So there is the movie Greenland, starring Gerard Butler, skipping theatrical release in the United States. It's going straight to premium video on demand. Eros STX making the decision to release it in the fourth quarter. HBO will have it for pay TV cable first, and then it'll stream on HBO Max in 2021. Butler stars with Marina Baccarin. They are an estranged couple trying to keep their family alive as a planet-killing comet heads toward Earth. I think it's set in 2020. Another Netflix project called Spiderhead making a casting announcement. Chris Hemsworth, Miles Teller, and Journey Smollett all added to the picture. It's being directed by Joseph Kaczynski. It's based on the short story by George Saunders. The story is set in the near future where convicts get a chance at a reduced sentence if they agree to participate as medical subjects for a test involving emotion-altering drugs. What could possibly go wrong? Tor Books announcing the acquisition of the English rights to The Genesis of Misery. It is a debut novel from, let me hit that button there. It is a debut novel from Neon Yang, retelling the Joan of Arc story with a space opera setting, including a giant robot. The story follows Misery Numaki. Hears a voice in her head, knows it's a delusion. This voice choosing a warrior champion for a holy war on a remote moon colony, and survival depends on mastering a big robot mech. Gundam type of thing. It is the beginning of the Null Void Chronicles, and that will be out 2022. A few weeks ago, we reported Don Coscarelli was looking for a clean copy of Beastmaster, and whether or not he found it in between times, we do have now news of a new 4K Ultra HD version of the Beastmaster. Coscarelli says the company Vinegar Syndrome tracked down a pristine interpositive print of the film in the Warner Brothers vault. They assembled a bunch of extras for a brand new collection. It'll be out on 4K and Blu-ray edition, complete with feature-length behind-the-scenes documentary, a 40-page book with a bunch of extras yet to be announced. It is now available for pre-order, and it will ship sometime after Vinegar Syndrome's holiday Black Friday sale around Thanksgiving. Deadline is reporting that Netflix has made a deal to develop a new live-action series featuring Conan the Barbarian. It's a new deal with Conan Properties International, which is owned by Cabinet Entertainment. Frederick Momberg, who's the executive over there, will be one of the producers. This gives Netflix the rights to the Conan Literary Library for live-action and animated projects to develop. They're currently looking for a writer and showrunner and a director for the new series. The Witcher making a change for season two with regard to the character Witcher Eskel. Pop that over there. Theo Thur Ersted Rasmussen had filmed scenes back in February and March, but now with the pandemic lockdowns affecting schedules, he's had to exit because of a conflict. So Basil Idenbenz will take over the role. The show was one of the first to get hit with the lockdown back in March. They resumed production August 17th. And there is a rumor over at Redandian Intelligence. I'm not familiar with this site, so bags of salt is ready. Say, take it for what it's worth. They say that Netflix could be considering more spinoffs besides the animated feature already announced and the prequel, Blood Origin. Those two we know about. Daniel Richtman, who's an insider, says he's hearing another project could focus on the witches in the story. Nothing is confirmed, nothing official. This is a rumor at this point, and we will be back with more right after this.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.
When it comes to Star Wars news, is it better to get it in the corporate package or from fellow fans? For all the latest news, rumor, and speculation, check us out on Sci-Fi for Me TV, Salacious Crumbs.
Walden Media, you know them for the Chronicles of Narnia films. They are bringing to TV the fantasy novel Savvy from Ingrid Law. And Marcy Martin, who plays Diane Johnson on ABC's Blackish, her Genius Entertainment shingle hanging above this project. It is about a teenager named Mibbs Beaumont, well, about to become a teenager, looking forward to her 13th birthday when she finds out what her savvy will be. This is what they call their supernatural powers. Now, when she learns she can read minds, it's not exactly a great thing for a teenager to be able to do. Martin says, at its core, it's a story of a young girl trying to unlock her potential. She says it's something we can all relate to, powers or no. Warner Brothers and Studio 8 making a deal with Kwanzaa Asajifo and Tim Smith III for an adaptation of Black. This is set in a world where only black people have superpowers. Titans producer Brian Edward Hill is working on the script, and production will be supervised by Studio 8's Jeff Robinov, Guy Danella, and John Graham, Black Mass Comics, Matteo Pizzolo, and Brett Gerwitz, all of those set as producers. It follows teenager Kareem Jenkins. He discovers he has superpowers after getting shot by police in Brooklyn. And this has been in the works since 2017. Studio 8 says their goal is to develop a franchise out of the deal. And according to The Hollywood Reporter, Billy Crudup reported to be in early negotiations to join The Flash, to rejoin The Flash on the big screen opposite Ezra Miller. He was originally cast to play Henry Allen back when Rick Famuyiwa was set to direct all the way back in 2016. He played Barry's father in one scene in Justice League, and now it looks like things have come full circle with all of the schedules being messed up and then not messed up, and then the project was on and then the project was off, and now it's all timed out to where he can come back and play the part that he originally played already. We followed that, right? DC Comics announcing a Wonder Woman Earth 1 Volume 3. This will complete the trilogy by Grant Morrison and Yannick Paquette. Diana is now queen of the Amazons. She has to assemble all of the Amazons to unite and fight back against Max Lord and his army. This is the conclusion to the Earth One story. It hits the shelves March 9th, 2021. In this report, a rumor about the Orville. We don't get very much of that. Giant freaking robot, yes, I know, but they're reporting. A source tells them that one of the reasons why the show is taking so long to get done is they're trying to figure out the ending of the season. Because according to them, again, giant freaking robot, take this for what it's worth, according to them, Seth MacFarlane doesn't want to make any more past season 3. Hulu would like more. MacFarlane would want to go on to focus on more serious projects. You know, we have The Cosmos is back. He's on Skywatch for Peacock. And he's developing this new adaptation of The Winds of War miniseries. So maybe MacFarlane is done with comedy. Hulu wants more Orville. MacFarlane doesn't want to do it. He wants to kill off Captain Mercer. Hulu doesn't want to do the show unless MacFarlane is involved. So that's where we are with that, according to Giant Freaking Robot. We will see how that plays out, because Giant Freaking Robot, I know, we share, so you know. Possibly a surprise to no one, we got this covered. See, I'm going to put them all at one in one spot here. We got this covered, ran a story that Bill and Ted 4 was in the works. This time there's a twist. Writer-director Ed Solomon posted on Twitter that it's the first he's hearing about it. Debunked the whole thing. And occasionally we report things from We Got This Covered, but now we do try, for the record, we do try to look for it elsewhere whenever we find something there, because due diligence and responsibility, we want to make sure that we get the stories right. And when we can, we're able to go back to the original source. If We Got This Covered is the only source, we make a note of it, and we do give you the warning, as we've done, that you should have your salt handy. They're hit and miss. At best. Now, somehow, I think we missed this. Back at the end of August, The Hollywood Reporter had the story that Disney Channel will be the home for a new adaptation of Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur. That's the title for the animated series. It's based on Jack Kirby's Devil Dinosaur comic from 1978. Marvel Animation and Family is the production company. Produced by Steve Loader, who served on the Kim Possible staff, and Cinema Gypsy Productions. This is Lawrence Fishburne and Helen Suglin's company. They will be executive producers. The story follows 13-year-old Lunella Lafayette and her pet dinosaur, Devil, who is in modern times because of an accidental time vortex. This apparently was announced at D23, and we missed it. My apologies. Some casting news for another Marvel show on Disney Plus. Deadline reports that newcomer Iman Vellani, did I get that right? Vellani, has been cast as the title character for Ms. Marvel. She'll play Kamala Khan. The character first appeared in Marvel Comics in 2014 to take over the moniker after the previous Ms. Marvel, Carol Danvers, became the new Captain Marvel. Marvel Chief Creative Officer of Kevin Feige has stated that Kamala Khan will appear in films as well, so she apparently has a long career ahead of her. Vellani was part of a group of students that made up the Next Wave Committee of the Toronto International Film Festival. She's only 17 or 18 years old at this point. They've selected certain titles during the film festival that they thought would be important to young people. She's a high school senior with an interest in cinematography and, by the way, gave Captain Marvel 2 out of 5 stars. And a casting rumor, this one for Hawkeye. Phantom Wire reporting that the show will feature Bobby Morse, also known as Mockingbird, last seen on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., played by Adrian Palicki. But, according to this story, the role will be recast now that Kevin Feige is in charge of both film and television operations. But this is Fandom Wire, so take that for what it's worth. And website The Illuminati has a report about Marvel's Moon Knight. Grains of salt at the ready. This is going to wind a little bit. They report the show could start production by the end of the year, maybe as early as November, and they claim to have concrete casting news about the lead character, Mark Spector. They say Marvel is looking at Keanu Reeves. Now, the rumor is they've been communicating since Captain Marvel, and we've heard that there have been conversations between Marvel and Keanu Reeves back and forth as far back. Maybe he was going to have the Jude Law role, but this is a rumor for now. However, YouTube personality War Stew, citing Roger Waddell, says not so fast. He's hearing that Keanu is being considered, but not for Moon Knight. There's too much of a time commitment. Keanu Reeves is a little bit older for that role. Instead, according to War Stew, or according to Roger Wardell, by way of War Stew, let's get this right, Keanu Reeves is being considered as Johnny Blaze, the Ghost Rider, and might appear in Doctor Strange 2, at least as a cameo. Now, again, nothing official, and of course everything's been pushed back with Black Widow now moving to May 7th of 2021, which moves Shang-Chi to July 9th, moves the Eternals to November 5th. So there's plenty of time for things to change. The Hollywood Reporter does have a surprise casting announcement. Jamie Foxx is in talks to reprise his role as Electro and the upcoming Spider-Man film from Sony and Marvel, supposed to hit theaters in December of 2021. Now, Fox confirmed it on Instagram before deleting the post. Grace Randolph reports this is likely multiverse stuff because Fox was part of The Amazing Spider-Man 2 starring Andrew Garfield, which was the reboot trilogy after the trilogy we got with Tobey Maguire. So, not even the Marvel Cinematic Universe, but now apparently it is. Maybe the Marvel Cinematic Multiverse, I guess. Randolph says that the WandaVision is going to split the multiverse, rip it open, and make all of these possibilities possible. And then we'll deal with it a little bit in the new Spider-Man 3 with Tom Holland and now Jamie Foxx as Electro. And then they put things back together sort of in Doctor Strange 2. And then they kick off Secret Invasion. Maybe. Now remember, Sam Raimi is directing Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. And he directed the original Tobey Maguire Spider-Man trilogy. So if Electro is back, how many other villains from the Raimi films could show up? We've seen J.K. Simmons back as some version of J. Jonah Jameson. Could we be getting the Sinister Six, some version of it? We know Kraven the Hunter is getting his own film, so that leaves Kraven, Electro, Vulture. We don't have Doc Ock yet, but we do have Mysterio. We don't have Sandman, but if they pull them in from the other trilogies, we could have our Sinister Six, and maybe that one's back on the table over at Sony. Anything is possible at this point. The website Watch Time India, speaking of Doctor Strange, it's an online magazine about luxury watches, and they had an interview with Benedict Cumberbatch about his watch interest. Apparently he's a connoisseur. He's also an avid diver, so watches are very important there as well. He tells them shooting on Doctor Strange 2 could start late October or early November. And Marvel Comics is announcing a new Werewolf by Night. This is a series written by Taboo and Ben Jackendoff, art by Scott Eaton. It follows a young man named Jake dealing with the effects of a family curse. It includes a revamp and update of the Marvel character Red Wolf. This is out October 21st. And Heritage Auctions has two items going up for sale of interest to some. The first, Milo Manara's alternate cover to Spider-Woman from 2014, part of the European Comic Art Event. This sale is October 3rd and 4th. Now, it will be the original cover illustration without the trade dress. And then in the next couple of weeks, October 15th and 16th, and the Rare Books event, you have this first edition of Frank Herbert's Dune, signed by Sterling Lanier, the editor who pushed it through to get published at Chilton Books. Now, Chilton, normally known for auto repair manuals, they published Dune for the first time after 23 other publishers rejected the book. Lanier was on to something. He says, we've got to publish this. Matthew Vaughn's production company, Marv, has hired former Lionsgate Europe CEO Ziggy Kamasa as their new group CEO. He'll oversee the expansion of the Kingman franchise into television, plus all the global sales, marketing, distribution. Kamasa says the idea is to take Marv to the next stage. And Daniel, your question in the chat about killing off Mysterio, remember, Mysterio's entire shtick was all about illusion. So he could be dead. But if he is dead, it's a comic book death. But he could have faked his death. We'll see. Miles Luna has announced his departure from Rooster Teeth. He was co-creator of Ruby. He's a writer. He's a voice actor on several shows. He says he's leaving after 10 years for other pursuits in the gaming industry, among other places. He will continue to write and voice John in the show Ruby. And this follows several high-profile departures, including Ruby lead animator Ian Kentward, Rooster Teeth co-founder Joel Hyman, Micah Burton. 13% of the staff was laid off earlier this year, and the online store is closing. So things are not entirely looking great over there. And we will be back with more right after this. We are going to put some rules in place.
The grown-ups are back. And this time...
Don't lose it.
No subject is sacred.
When they're making fun of him for being a Christian...
Well, but
no issue is ignored.
This is a tragedy. This is a horrible thing.
And no one is safe.
But as someone who deals with depression, this is an issue with me.
The H2O Podcast, Monday night at 8, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
A new kind of film just released asks the question, if you could become a god, would you? Short film, Agents, released on Monday by the studio Transitional Forms and the National Film Board of Canada. It's described as a dynamic film, and it uses virtual reality and machine learning to let viewers make a choice. You can either star in the story and actually interact with various different pieces of the film, or you can only observe. And your interactions will affect how the story plays out. Sounds a little interesting there. And Godzilla game producer Shunsuke Fujita, in an interview with the fan site Gomaru Island, they were asking if there'd be a follow-up to the 2014 PS4 game Godzilla vs. This was from Bandai Namco. He says, if there's enough fan feedback, it's possible. They have more information from him about something, but Fujita couldn't talk about it. The comment has prompted a petition at change.org, started by Kyle Weller of the High Flyers Tag Team YouTube channel. There's also a push to make social media posts in support of a new game. And that is the post there where it starts. All right, so then we have, let me hit that button there. Leslie Benzies, he formerly of Rockstar Games and Grand Theft Auto fame, has a new venture in the works. He's secured north of $40 million to develop a new sci-fi game that could compete with his former place of employment and Grand Theft Auto 6. The game is called Everywhere. Benzies' new studio, Build a Boy Games, just went live with a new website on this. There's not a whole lot of details. They're developing the game with input from the gamer community. Benzies and Rockstar had a public falling out in 2016. Benzies took them to court, claiming the company owed him $150 million in royalties. No details on Everywhere yet. It is described as an open-world adventure. Amazon's Lumberyard game engine is being used for that. And if you've been paying attention in the gaming world, and Nintendo Switch in particular, there have been some hacks and piracy over the years. Team Executor apparently has a reputation. They are a group responsible for hacking and pirating the Switch operating system, and they now have two fewer pirates. Department of Justice announcing two leaders of Executor, Max Loarn of France and Gary Bowser of the Dominican Republic, have been arrested. Bowser has been extradited to the U.S. Loarn has yet to be. He is in the process there. They face 11 felony charges related to piracy going back 7 years. And congratulations to Roderick Pettigrew. Let me put that there. Need to give credit where credit is due there. He is the latest recipient of the Vannevar Bush Award, which honors science and technology leaders who have made substantial contributions to the welfare of the nation. The National Science Board making this announcement on Monday. Pettigrew is the founder of the National Institute of Biomedical Imaging and Bioengineering at the National Institutes of Health. His work focuses on transforming the relationship between technology and medical research. He's also the co-founder of NMED, which is an engineering and medical school initiative at Texas A&M University. And we will link to the announcement there for that, so you can read that full press release. And finally, this from Forbes. A study published in the scientific journal PLOS ONE. Researchers attempted to determine if DNA of insects enclosed in resinous material, like amber, could be preserved, and if so, for how long. Using ambrosia beetles trapped in amber, stored for 2 to 6 years and then processed, it turns out it is possible to extract DNA from the samples, but it's very fragile. And it also has a tendency to break down depending on what chemicals you use to dissolve the resin. So next, now that they know they can do it, they'll try to determine the decay rate of the DNA. Who knows what happens next? Well, wait, we saw that movie. All right, that's going to do it for us this morning. Thanks very much for tuning in. If you are watching this in replay, don't forget you can leave a comment with your thoughts. And please feel free to share. If you like what you see, you can throw a thumbs up. If you are not subscribed to the channel yet, we do invite you to do so, although it's not an obligation. And we do appreciate all of the people who come in to watch what we do here on this show and all of our other shows. Don't forget, we do have Tartar Sauce next week, as well as a new Triple Bites on Tuesday. And then, of course, all week, Monday through Thursday, we have Live from the Bunker at noon Central. And we do invite you to check that out. It is an interview conversation program. And next week, we have a full week of guests joining us for various different conversations. And that's going to do it for us here this morning. Thank you very much for being here. Have a good weekend.
Copyright 2020 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.